I'm Clara Grossman, and I was born in Hungary, in a small town called Nyírbátor. And I had three brothers and sisters. I had an older brother, Imre, and a younger sister, Magda, and a little brother, Jenő, and my father's name was Armin, and my mother, Anna. I was born in 1930, September 6th, and we were a religious family, quite religious. It was a happy family. I have very fond memories. Started school at 5 and went into kindergarten. And I remember my brother being a year older. I felt sorry for him. He had to get up at 5 in the morning to go to Heder and study and then go to school the whole day. And in our home, we always had either an aunt or some kind of relative living, because my mom just took care of the whole world. We went to school and played and helped with my aunt, step-aunt, who lived there, and we all had chores. My father traveled a lot on business. He had a raw chemical business, and took him away during the week, but on Friday he was always home for the Sabbath, and that was our family time together. Life in Nyírbátor, I remember being given 6, 7, was very difficult for Jews. We were always constantly persecuted, beaten up, harassed. It was never a day that we could just walk down on the street and with our head high up. Always had to look around if someone was lurking around to beat us up. So it was happy and yet very difficult and sad. As a little girl, I just, from conversation with my parents, my mom always wanted to come to the United States. She had an uncle who wanted to bring us all out and send constantly affidavits. But my father, being so religious, he just never felt that he could practice his religion. And his business was all established, and you know, it was a big step. And they always kept putting it off. And as time went on, we went to a Jewish school. We went to regular school, and then later on, we were not allowed to go anymore. I think in the sixth grade, we were suddenly asked not to come to school anymore. That was in, I think in 42, something like that. And the Jewish community set up a Jewish school, and all the Jewish children attended that school. Life went on. And was talked that the Germans will be coming in. They were occupying more and more. And my father's business, which was the chemical business, one day was just taken away from him. He couldn't own business anymore. He had to take in a Gentile partner. And then, you know, that was, you know, quite difficult. And one day we were told that we had to wear a yellow star. And first on the arm, and then on our sewn in into our clothes. As time went by, more and more information was coming about how bad things were, and that the Germans are very, very close. And one Sunday, I remember it very, very, very clearly, they just walked in into town. They were just all over the place, and with trucks and tanks and all equipment, they were there. And I just knew that after that, life never be the same. It was scared. I could see it. My parents, so scared for all of us. It was in March 19th in 44. One day they just rapped on our doors, and the Hungarian gendarme, the police, came and told us that to pack up baggage, a suitcase that we could carry, and because we will be taken to assembly area and possibly go to a ghetto not far from our hometown. They picked the synagogue to assemble us, and before we were taken away, my parents called each of us and showed where they hid some of the jewelry, and in the basement into a steel box, and some of the valuable items where we had a crawl space in the attic. So each of us knew. And I said to myself, well, we really don't have to know this because we'll all be together. I just couldn't even accept the fact. And we were in the temple, the synagogue. All of us looked scared and trying to figure out what will be the next step. And all the elderly were trying to get some news. And then after a terrible night, the next day assembled us, and they said, we are going to a small town called Shimopusta, to the ghetto. And it was like 30 kilometers walking, and in lots, like 3,000 Jews were in that our town, all lined up and walking, and the fellow Gentile people just stood on the sidewalk and cheering along, some of them, and get rid of you, and terrible things. And you know, I just, as a child, I couldn't believe this is really happening. And we finally got there. It was a farm area, nothing. They were temporary barracks were built to house us, and straw was laid down and just a blanket over it, and everybody staked out their little corner or area, and their outside was an open, like a grill, you know, area to cook. And you were, each family were responsible for their own food. And only they gave, you know, milk and some soup. The rest of it, you know, we had to provide. We were there for about 3 weeks. One day, they told us to gather our belongings, and we went up to the Nyíregyháza where the trains were, and they had all the boxcars lined up, huge, I don't know how many, but 10 or 20 of them. And gathered us, and 75 or 80 of us into a boxcar. And it just thought this was it. There was little just slits under the train, on the cars, crowded, no sanitary equipment. I mean, this was it. You had to do everything in this car. You couldn't breathe. You were choking. It was no food. It was so inhuman. It was so horrible. I thought this is it. I mean, we will never make it. And my mother, I never forget, she was trying so hard to keep saying it will be okay, not to worry. My father always praying. No one was listening. Took, seems forever and ever. Some people just never made it. They died, and they tried to shield it from the younger ones. And finally, after 3 days, the train stopped, and it was like 5 in the morning. People looked out and saw people lined up in striped uniform and lots of noise. It was a big platform. And they opened the doors and lights all over, glaring. Cold morning. It was, I think, in May. And lots of soldiers, SS soldiers with their guns and bayonets. And all the workers, we saw a sign, said Auschwitz. And you didn't know what was happening. It was just German shepherds, dogs all over, lined up, screaming, come fast, fast, rouse, rouse, and drop everything. Everything will be sent to you. Just leave it where it is. Line up 5 in a row and separate the men and the women. And my father and brother went to my cousin to one side, and we went this side. And we still didn't know what was going on. My cousin, who was visiting Shari, who couldn't go back, she was tall, and she was on the end in the front, holding my hand, and my little brother was holding my hand. My brother, my mother, and my sister suddenly just knew we were caught like this. We were thrown one side, we were thrown another side. This last time I saw my mom and my sister and my brother, we were pushed to one side. It seemed like mostly young women. I was like 14 years old, and but as tall as I am now and developed, and it's fortunately it was dark, so they couldn't see, you know, how young I was. I don't know if it was fortunate or not, but this was decided that I had to go. I mean, we didn't know what side you were on. And they marched us into an area, and we had to undress and just keep our shoes on. And chairs were lined up. It was like a big tiled area. And all the Gestapos and SS all running around, everybody. Suddenly you pushed into a chair and they shaved your hair completely. And you were like in a daze. You just really didn't know what was going on. You were moved along like in an assembly line and they just pushed you completely. I just kept holding my cousin, trying to get be together, not to be separated. And we were then taken into a huge shower area, and we really didn't know that much about the crematorium at that time. You didn't know what was going on, what will be. But water came out, and they said, scrub yourself, and DDT and all that, and threw us some clothes and some kind of shoes. And we put it on, and it just looked at each other. We just couldn't even recognize each other, who was friends or cousins standing next to me. We were lined up and taken out into a barrack area, sea lager, and put into a huge barrack. Lots of people were there, and was taken to bed area. It was wooden beds, and it was just wood and one single bed blanket, and we were shown that was it, and 10 of us in this small little area. And this went on a very long room, and there was a young woman who was charge of the barrack couple, and she was always screaming. And food, I mean, there was nothing first. First of all, we really didn't care. I mean, I didn't really wanted to live at that time. It was, why, for what for? And we were called outside to line up for the appeal. Every morning, 2 hours till they counted thousands and thousands of people. It was very cold, And if you moved, they pulled you out and they shot you right there. Or for no reason. They just went through, walked the German, the SS soldiers with sticks and constantly beating or pulling out or doing something. And if someone was missing, you had to stand for hours and hours. Either it was extremely cold or very hot later on. And then was sent back into the barracks and just waited, doing nothing. Then that in the evening again was the same thing, twice a day. And we were trying to get some news from family and from all anybody. We just couldn't find out. Finally, someone came. It was not far from our side. It was all women, but further down on Sea Lager were men barracks that my brother and my dad were in one of this is lager, and I snuck out and took a chance because they were constantly watching you, and you were not supposed to be walking out during unless you had something to do or some kind of work detail you were sent to. I ran down to see if I could see them, and I saw someone from my hometown. They called my father out, and he was, when he saw me, he just hugged me. He said, try to be strong, and try to stay together with all your cousins. And then my brother came out, and he looked so small and so helpless. And I said to my brother, take care of father. I had some bad bread ration that I never ate. And I had it in my dress, and I pulled it out and gave it to my dad. Because I heard he wouldn't eat the food, because it was not kosher. And I yelled at him, I said, kosher. I said, what's kosher? I said, there's no kosher here. It's nothing. I said, God is not watching and not looking after us. I was angry. So angry. Last time I saw them, saw my father. We stayed in Auschwitz. It seemed it was forever, but fortunately only for like 5 weeks. Days dragged on. We were constantly hungry. I mean, lost 30 pounds within 4 weeks. It was absolutely zero food. I mean, food, we were, garbage would look good if we could find it. We always volunteered for work detail to get out, to try to work close to the garbage dump, to see if we could get some potato peels or whatever, to try to survive. It was constant pain, hunger pain, and the weakness. And some of my friends and cousins, which was a huge support system, which is really responsible for all of us to be alive, because we really sort of took care of each other. I was the youngest in the group. And but fortunately strong and tried to take care of myself as much as I could. The more we volunteered for the work detail, it seemed that it helped, because one day they called us to an appeal around noontime, and we didn't know what it would be. Either we are, this is it, sent to the gas chambers. By that time, we knew what was going on. Every day, the smoke was billowing out. And you just, we were like zombies. We never even wanted to think about this. This is happening. We just went on and tried to make each hour or each day. And that day when they called us to the appeal at noon, and they started looking at everybody very closely, and they picked out from this line on that line, and we were five of us, my cousins, and they threw all five onto one side, and they picked out 1,000 young women that fairly, you know, looked in fairly good condition still, but we didn't think so. And took us into back into another area and undressed us and showered us again, which each time you went in there, you didn't know that this was the water coming out or gas. So we were sent out into, we didn't know, but it was 1,000 of us, to the train again, into the boxcars, and sent to Stutthof. This was another camp. Before we left, they said they selected us for a work camp, and if we work hard, we will be fed and taken care of, but if we didn't, we were sent back to Auschwitz to die. So, naturally, the main goal was to keep eating as much. I mean, eating, there was no food, but try to gather all our strength and work hard. And me being the youngest, I was constantly threatened to be sent back if I didn't work hard to Auschwitz. We did shoveling coal, from digging ditches very, very deep, laying pipes, sewers. They took us every morning to a work site. We worked from 8 to 7:30 in the morning to like 7 o'clock at night, and hardly any food. I mean, just little soup, which was water, and a little piece of bread and some black water that they called coffee. The camp was terrible. It was just as bad almost as Auschwitz. We were constantly with therapy. Before we went to work, we had to stood a pill, and then we got back. We were, as soon as you had to pull all your strength together, because if you showed any weakness, you were finished. And at night, I mean, just fell into bed. I mean, we had, maybe it was better, you just didn't have the energy or the time to the strength or the time to think about how horrible things were, how hopeless it was. And we, as I said, we tried to encourage each other and help each other. Then one day they were lined us up, got all the 1,000 girls to an appeal again, and they, on the loudspeaker, came through that we are shipped to another work site. The work was finished here. A new group is coming in to Braunau. We were again taken with another transport to Braunau, which was near Lublin, I think, near Warsaw, not in Poland. It was in the Polish-German border. This was in July of 44. We tried very much. Well, my cousins, the five of us, we always, you know, stayed together, but we had from our hometown lots of some of my other cousins and friends to stay together. I worked for a while. First, the winter was coming, worked outside with different, again, building, laying pipes and shoveling coal. It was getting so cold, and we had no clothing. We were frozen, our hands were frozen, our feet were frozen. Shoes were just nothing. We tried papers and cardboard to keep us warm. And there was the chance to go into the factories and be warm or be being poisoned, because it was all hand grenades. We had to, actually, we were doing is the bombs were coming through, and we had to look through a light, sat at a table, and they all come through, and if there was any little crack, then it you had to pull it out because it was defected. And you inhaled all the poison. We got lips green, our skin turned all yellow, our hands were all yellow, everything tasted bitter. There were rumors coming that they are taking us back to Auschwitz, that the war is coming, the Russian troops are coming on one side, the American troops on the other end. It was in January of 45. Then one day, we, after the appeal, they said that we will gather everybody in another hour, and we will have to get out of the camp. And they didn't offer any other information, just that we will walk towards a train station and go. Will ship us back. We have to, orders came that we should go back to Auschwitz. So we lined up and we started walking. It was.
Was your cousin Shari with
Shari you? Came out from the hospital, and she couldn't really walk. So we all took turns. They made a sled for her.
They meaning
the German. Office, one of the German officers, a woman, the Wehrmacht, made a sled, and she said, you take her on this, because she can't walk. And we pulled her and walked. The snow was this high, no clothing. It was so cold. It was terribly cold. And it came towards the evening, and they saw a big barn, two big farmhouses, and they split us up, and we went into the barn, and that's where we spent the evening. And our group, we sat and we started thinking what we should do. And we talked about trying to stay to the end of the line and see what happens, and if they're really watching us that closely or not. We saw that they were sort of trying to hide themselves and get away and not really, didn't care as much about us anymore. They were scared, because you could hear from far off the bombings, and they knew the troops were coming closer. And we just kept saying that they won't have a chance ever to get us back to Auschwitz. So we, the next morning, start marching again, and it was kept go going back and back and back to the line, and suddenly we looked around and there was no soldiers around us, no one guarding us. So we couldn't believe it. We kept looking and looking, and we said, what happened? And they just sort of took off. So we, five of us, and Shari, naturally, we wanted to saw a road, and we said, well, we'll turn off on the first road. It was a huge farmhouse.
Were you still pulling her on the side?
Yes. Then suddenly, a woman, a guard from the camp, which we knew her, she said, I'll take her. And we said, no, we are. She says, no, I'll take her. And she just took her and left. And I was hysterical. I didn't want to be separated from her. I didn't know what. I said, that's it. They're going to kill her. And we stood. And we couldn't do a thing. She says, if you move, I will shoot you all. And she went off with Shari. And we just cried, and we didn't know what to do. I said, well, we should walk after. And she says, I don't want you to, any of you, move. So we walked on down to the little road and walked into this farmhouse, and no one was there. It was empty. We didn't know where we were, what town, what area. I think it was like 7, 8 or maybe 10 of us. My cousins, some of my cousins, and some friends from our hometown. We were there for like 5 days, maybe, you know, a little longer. And then one day we heard, you know, the bombing and the war noises coming closer and closer. Then one day five Russian officers on horseback just came in. They said, we put up a flag, a white flag, and said, we are from a camp nearby. One of the officers came, gathered us in one room, and he said, look, I would advise you girls to leave. The troops are coming through here. We gathered as much food as we could, you know, carry with us, and started walking into Lublin. We walked into Warsaw, and we finally found a train that was going to Krakow, and we had no money. And then, you know, finally they let us go on the train.
Were you still wearing your uniform?
Yes, still wearing, was shaved. No shoes, hardly any, just some rags. Head filled with lice. We were filthy, dirty. I had never, you know, no bath. Only that, you know, the showers that they gave us maybe once, you know, and twice. Sick. And we got to Krakow, and then slowly, somehow, worked our way to the Hungarian border and into Budapest. Came back to finally to near Bartol, and it took us, you know, quite a while, at least 2 to 3 months to, you know, somehow a little bit pull ourselves together. And then each day someone else came. My brother, one day, summer, just walked in to our home. We had 53 Hertz cousins living in near Bator, and 12 of us came back. We decided to go back to Budapest, and the Russians the communism, the Russians were there, and communism was just really starting to flourish, and we really didn't want to be a part of it. I was constantly asked to join the Communist Party, and I refused all the time, tried to, and it was getting more and more difficult, and it was time to leave, and we went up to Budapest, sold everything, got as much money together, and got somehow through to Vienna. And from Vienna, there was already Hayes and UNRWA set up to help the displaced people. And they contacted us, and we were taken to Ulm. And it was like a real regular little town. It had the schools set up, and then it was the hospital, and we lived out of the camp area. There were apartments set up. There were orphans, babies, all ages, and us, the older children, took care of. Went to school during the day. Regular school was set up. And by the army, you know, the American, one of the organizations. And then after school, we worked in the nursery and the hospital, different chores we had, and took care of the younger children. Then one day, we were called that our papers have come true, and we were flown to Bremerhaven, took the train to Bremerhaven and boarded a ship, my brother and I, and came to the United States.
When was that?
It was in April of 48, and I never forgot the day when the ship pulled in into the harbor, saw the Statue of Liberty. I never thought I would ever see that or make it and come back. And it was just freedom. Never have to worry and be scared. Beaten up and humiliated. Could look up and be proud that I'm a Jew.